Good evening, I'm Jim Whaley. Tonight it's a pleasure to have as my guest on Cinema Showcase and to welcome him back to the program one of America's funniest men, Mr. Paul Lynde. Right now he's starring in Theater of the Stars production of The Impossible Years. I hope you will join me tonight as I talk with Paul Lynde on Cinema Showcase. Thank you very much for joining Cinema Showcase tonight. And right now, join me in welcoming back to the program Mr. Paul Lynde. Paul, it's a pleasure to have you.
Thank you, Tom.
It's been a couple of years, I guess, since you were here last.
Yes.
You're now doing The Impossible Years, which is a very funny play. I saw the movie, and naturally the plays, I think...
I've never seen the movie. Was it David
David Niven, Lola Albright, I believe.
Lola, I thought it was... the girl that always played with John Wayne.
Maureen O'Hara?
Maureen O'Hara.
No.
Are you sure it's not Maureen?
I may be wrong, but I think it was Lola Albright.
Lola, I love Lola Albright. I didn't know she was. I don't think she did it. I think you're wrong.
Okay. I'm wrong.
I don't know. I've never seen the movie. Yeah.
Is the play fun to do? It's wonderful to watch, but is it a fun show for actors to do?
Well, I'll tell you. I'm the first person on stage, which is, you know, the star likes to be the last. And I'm the first person that walks on the stage. Mm-hmm. And that's bad writing. as Lynn Fontaine said, theater is entrances and exits. But I walk on, I'm the first person that speaks in this play.
Yeah.
And I just take a lot of deep breaths before I go out. Elizabeth Allen, my co-star, taught me that. I've appeared with her so many times because I'm a very nervous person when I perform. And she says, just suck in as much air as you can, darling, and it'll give you a high and you won't be nervous. And I do that just before I go on. And it's a strange play. It really is. It's not a great play. It's a play that works fantastically for me.
Mm-hmm.
And the rapport I have with the audience is so gratifying. It's such a joy because I love to hear people laugh.
Yeah, yeah.
That's my business, and they don't giggle. They scream for an hour and almost 2 hours. Hour and 45 minutes is a short play. I like short plays. It's a real joy to do it, is as simply as I can put it, because the audience is so entertained.
Yeah. Well, is there a question of, I know you're touring in this show, you've been in Dallas, or
we're headed for Dallas. We've been in Akron, I'll name the great cities. Akron, Columbus, Dayton, Flint, Michigan, Toledo, Milwaukee, Norfolk, and now, of course, here.
Mm-hmm.
And then we go on to Dallas for 2 weeks. It's the only place we're playing 2 weeks. And then Houston, which is sort of the reward. It's a fun town.
Yeah. Well, I was going to ask
a lot
you,
of fun there.
Do audiences differ from place to place?
No. I don't think so at all. Not at all.
That's good.
They don't. I tell the cast that. I say, every opening night is a big adjustment, especially here in Atlanta. It's so enormous, the theater.
Oh, yeah.
And... the cast last night, they said, do you think they like it or not? And I said, yes, they do. It's just that it's so vast and so big that you can't hear. We were much closer to the audience than the other theaters. And last night when they gave us a standing ovation, it was really thrilling. And everything I told the cast, I knew they were appreciating it out there. But every theater is different. Every audience is different, but they don't vary that much if you perform at your top level. They don't. They're very receptive people. And I always tell everyone I work with, I say, always act like it's opening night, because none of those people out there have seen us do this play.
Yeah.
And you've got to make it look like it's the first time you've done it. Well, I can't stand actors, you know, that walk through a part. But, you know, you hear that a lot. I've never worked with an actor that walks through a part. If they do, I just, you know, get a gun and kill them.
Don't
fool around. No, if you walk through a role, you don't belong in show business.
Yeah.
You've got to act like it's the first time you've ever done the role, because no one in that audience has seen you do it. Mm-hmm. And
but each night you're still nervous.
Always. And, you know, I was told by so many people that it would lessen and it would get easier for me, and it hasn't.
Mm-hmm.
It has gotten to the point that you know, I constantly talking about retiring, because there's got to be more fun than performing. It's such a challenge. It's such a demanding thing.
Yeah.
And such a responsibility. And I'm lazy. And you know, I'm getting up there in years, and I want to go dancing and have fun. And performing is an enormous responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
Enormous.
Well, I guess you reach a point where you, you owe your audiences something? Or?
You owe them everything. You owe them your life, your money, everything you have. That's why I do the autograph line. I love to meet them, because
mm-hmm.
I never get to see them. You know, in Hollywood, I'm in a limousine or a car or when I go to the studios, the guards are there, and you never get to be with them.
Sure.
And on these summer tours, you know, people will say, "Oh, Mr. Lynde, I'm just so glad you do the autograph line. You know, a lot of people won't do this." And I say, "Well, I only do it because I enjoy it, or I wouldn't do it."
Mm-hmm.
There's no reason other than you enjoy it. And they are the barometer of my career.
Mm-hmm.
I don't read critics. I usually am destroyed by critics. I just go by those people. They're who put me where
sure.
I am, wherever I am, and I just love to meet them and talk with them, and they say such beautiful things.
Well, did you have any idea? You've been doing the summer shows regularly for about, what, 10 years now?
Yeah, just about, yes.
Did you have any idea when you started that it would be as phenomenally successful as it has been? Because everywhere you go, you literally break records with audiences.
Well, it's a great personal compliment, naturally. But the main reason I go out, it's really not the money. It is to be with them.
Mm-hmm.
I so rarely get to be with those people out there that I never get to see
yeah.
or meet, and
yeah.
It's very rewarding to be with them, and it renews my whole belief in our nation. It's my favorite country in the
mm-hmm.
world. I've been all over the world, and I love America. And my audiences are my morale.
Yeah.
They're so fabulous.
Laughter, I think, is such an important thing, and I think too many artists don't give it as much importance as they should. I mean, for when awards time come around, comedies never win.
Oh, awards.
Rarely.
Awards, everyone likes to win, but you know, it's like the Oscars. The most fun night I have at my house is I always invite over some very special friends, and we watch the Oscars, because it's so dull to go there. I'll go if I'm ever nominated. But we have so much fun. We have popcorn, and we put money in the pot,
yeah.
and we're very much into the business,
mm-hmm.
and I rarely win. No one wins I want. I just think, you know, the five people that are nominated, there shouldn't be an Oscar. I respect George Scott for not taking his Oscar. I respect Marlon Brando. There's no way that you can give an Oscar when five performances are that brilliant
mm-hmm.
and that different. There's no. They should give five Oscars. That's what it should be.
Well, you know, they tried to do that one year with
the
Emmys.
They should do it.
They tried it with the Emmys.
There's no way one. It's like the best dog in show. There's no
yeah.
best dog in a show.
But you know what they discovered?
It's politics. There is no best.
Well.
To get the nomination
mm-hmm.
is the award. It really is.
But
out of so many actors.
Without the competition, it makes for not very interesting show to watch, though.
I know that is the you know, that's the appeal, the final winner, but it's so rough on the other four actors or actresses that didn't win it, and they were just as brilliant as the person that got it. It's very rough on them because they all won it, and I just think they should. It's so cruel, I think, to the other four losers.
I just wish that there would be a little more respect for comedies. I realize Annie Hall.
Oh, it's almost impossible for a comedian to win the award.
Why is that?
Well, that's, you know, Jeannie Holliday. She was up against stiff competition.
Oh, Betty
my
Davis.
Lord, Betty Davis and All About Eve, which is probably one of my all-time famous movies, favorite movies, and she was the best she's ever been in that movie. Gloria Swanson in Sunset Boulevard, which was her pièce de résistance, as you say. And you know, and for Judy to win that with that competition, it was incredible. It really was. It was the strangest year. I took for granted there was no chance. Because very rarely, you know, Jack Lemmon never won his Oscar until he did something serious.
That's right.
He'd never won it being a comic actor, which he's so brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
It's very difficult for a comic performer or comedian or whatever we are. I don't know what we are. But it's very difficult for us to get nominated or the Oscar.
Who makes you laugh?
Oh, that's a rough question, Jim, because as soon as I leave the studio, I'll say, oh, I didn't say that person's name and that. So I really don't answer that question anymore because I have so many dear friends that I'm afraid I'm going to forget.
Mm-hmm.
But dead is easy.
Right.
Oliver Hardy was my idol and still is. I didn't like Stan that much, but Oliver Hardy, and you know, when I was in my hometown, I never missed any of their movies, and I was criticized almost because I dug Laurel and Hardy movies.
Really?
I don't know, the kids, they say, oh, they're so silly, and and that's the word I love. They were silly, and they were gentle, and they never were mean, cruel, and they were so funny, especially Oliver. I just adored that man, and I loved M.C. Fields.
Oh, yeah.
Right next to Oliver.
Mm-hmm.
I never dug Charlie Chaplin.
That's interesting.
Yeah. I did in The Great Dictator. I dug him when he talked. I always thought he was like a puppet, and I like human beings when I'm watching funny people.
Mm-hmm.
And I never thought Charlie was that human. He was always like a marionette or something.
Mm-hmm.
And I just never laughed that much at him. And I hope he doesn't find I said that. Oh, he died.
Yeah.
I hope Una doesn't. Una Chaplin.
I think you hit on it, though, when you said about Laurel and Hardy. They were funny, yet they were gentle.
Oh.
And that, I think,
well, Oliver was the most gentle person in the world.
Mm.
He was, I laugh so hard at him that I just wouldn't miss anything he ever did.
When you were growing up, did you know all the time that you wanted to, eventually what you wanted to do as far as comedy is concerned?
I never knew about that, really, Jim. I was very poor, and I always wanted to be rich. It was like, I don't know, it was unbelievable. That's all I wanted to be, was rich. And I didn't care how I got it. If I'd been a good thief, I'd have been a good thief. I mean, show business wasn't that big a drive. I just wanted to be rich. And I found out that performing was the easiest way for me to get there. But when you say, I never really wanted to be a star, I just wanted to be rich. Because I think what you give up of your life, being a celebrity, I have many days where I say it's not worth it. And I always caution young people that want to go into this business, what you do give up. You give up a great part of your life.
Do you think show business demands any more from you as far as dedication goes than any other kind of business?
Well, I tell you, especially with the advent of television, When I always tell a plumber that when he's really goofed doing a job at my house, you know what, they get an hour. And I just say, you know, only you and I know you didn't do a good job. But mm-hmm. when I do a bad job, 60, 40, 50 million people yeah. watch me be bad. And that's a lot of yeah. people watching yeah. you be bad. And I think that's why it gets to every performer. You know, I've worked with such superstars, and I find they're just as insecure. Yeah. They feel that the moment they're performing is, it's got to be the best. You always got to, you hope it's better than the last thing you did. And mm-hmm. every time you're out there, it's like you're on a tightrope and you can fall any second and it's over. And I don't think any industry, any walk of work or life has the anxiety that an actor has, because you can fail mm-hmm. every time you go out there and end your career.
That question that was always brought up when they talk about people like Marilyn Monroe or Judy Garland.
One of my favorites.
Or Montgomery
Clift. She was a star. Marilyn yeah. Monroe was our last star, as far as I'm concerned.
But did the business
Barbara Streisand is a star, mm-hmm. but and Diana Ross is. Yeah. They're both stars, but nothing of the magnitude of Marilyn Monroe. Mm-hmm. No one disliked Marilyn Monroe. I never heard anybody, a woman, a child, a dog, a cat. No one was jealous of her. No one hated her. No, that's a star. Yeah. I was on my way to a bullfight in Mexico the morning that they came on the radio and said that she had died. And there was I was doing Bye Bye Birdie, the movie. And Jeff Parker, one of my best friends, he was an understudy in my first Broadway show, New Faces, and he adored Marilyn. He got so ill, we had to pull over the side of the road, and we had Una White's car. She had loaned it to us. Mm-hmm. And they were electric windows, and he started throwing up, and it got into the electric windows, and we couldn't get him to work. We had to get rid of all his clothes and go to an army surplus store so we'd go on to the bullfight. But we didn't have any fun that day.
Yes.
She was that kind of... I met her the first day I was in Hollywood.
Really?
Yes, I was doing New Faces, and she came over on the set. She was doing something at 20th Century Fox, mm-hmm. and she looked like a secretary. She had glasses on, and she came over, but she had seen New Faces in New York, and mm-hmm. she wanted to come over and say hello to us. And I'll never forget it, mm-hmm. as long as I live. And she had so much fun with us, and that's why she was a star.
But would she have had the eventual problem she had she been in any other kind of...
I don't think anyone understood her. I yeah. really don't. I loved what Russia said, you know, when she came up. You know, no one knows how, mm-hmm. why she died. But yeah. I loved what Russia said, which, you know, we're so distant from. And I loved their newspaper coverage. They said they felt that no one in America understood her. And it's true. Mm-hmm. None of those studios did. The way that she was treated on the last movie she was on, it was unforgivable. Mm-hmm. Unforgivable. But, you know, I talked to makeup people and wardrobe people, and Marilyn really didn't know how brilliant she was.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she became frightened to go in front of the camera because she thought her only talent was her looks, and uh-huh. she thought she was losing it. Oh. And she wouldn't go in front of the camera. She'd find any excuse not to go. Mm-hmm. But she was, I tell you, when Laurence Olivier said that he would never, never perform with her again because he said he knew no one was watching him.
True.
That is the greatest tribute to mm-hmm. Marilyn Monroe, because that show, that movie, Prince and the Showgirl.
Prince and the Showgirl, yeah.
Laurence Olivier, who is my Spencer Tracy and Lawrence English, Marlon Brando, my favorite actors, mm-hmm. He said he would never perform with her ever again because he knew no one was watching him.
Oh.
And, you know, I don't know whether she ever knew that yeah. or ever read that yeah. because she was so sheltered the last years of her life. Mm-hmm. But she was. She was Jean Harlow. She was that kind of star.
Yeah.
And Vivian Leigh and, you know, really superstar.
We have been having this week in Atlanta sort of a Paul Lynde Festival. One of your films was on TV here, I think, last night, Charlotte's Web.
Oh, Charlotte's Web.
Charlotte's Web, yeah.
I'm not in it, just my voice.
Just your voice. What a memorable voice characterization, though. And it's a good animated feature, as
you
opposed
know,
to many of them.
The girl that takes care of my shirts on Hollywood Square is who's such a divine girl named Christine. She knows the author of Charlotte's Web, mm-hmm. which right now I can't say. I wish I could. But she got me a personally autographed copy of Charlotte's Web, signed by him. And he saw the movie, and he said if there was anyone in the world that should have played Temple and the Rat, he said it was you. And I consider it E.J. White, I think. Is that right?
Yeah, E.B. White. Right.
It was the most beautiful note, and he so enjoyed the movie, really. Right. And that's great when the writer says he enjoyed the movie.
Of the films you've done, which stand out to you?
I've never done anything that stand out. The funniest thing I've done in a movie, which again I just had to plead and beg, and Norman Jewison, who directed it, was Send Me No Flowers, mm-hmm. and I played the funeral. I sold funeral plots. I tell you, Rock Hudson, who I adore, he's told me it was the roughest time he ever had to do, was to do. So we did the scene in one take because there was no way that we could do it in two takes. It's the funniest lines I've ever had. And I was so afraid I was going to fluff the lines because mm-hmm. all you do is say the words. Mm-hmm. And when I see that scene, I laugh. Yeah. And I rarely laugh at myself.
Yeah.
Rarely.
That's such a funny movie.
Well, Tony Randall, you know, he's funny. Yeah. Doris Day is she's one of the most instinctively funny women I've ever mm-hmm. performed with, and one of the nicest, and one of the most professional.
It's interesting, we talked about last time, one of your biggest hits anywhere was Bye Bye Birdie on stage, but yet you weren't that crazy about the movie, you said.
No. No. Dick Van Dyke and I were the only two from the Broadway show, and we enjoyed that show so much on mm-hmm. Broadway. It was a joy to go there every night. I've never heard an audience react the way they did to that show, and I was lucky. I was in New Faces and Bye Bye Birdie, 9 years apart, but both shows were fantastic audience shows, and, you know, that's where it's at. And I didn't have one line from the Broadway show in the movie. Oh. Not one line. They just bought the title and made it a vehicle for Anne Margaret, which I'm not putting Anne down. I mean, Lord, if that was given me, I'd take it.
Yeah.
But Dick and I adored that show. It just was magic to do. And the movie, I thought. But, you know, people that didn't see the Broadway show enjoyed the movie mm-hmm. very much. Mm-hmm. But I always say, do you see the stage show or the movie? Because the stage show was so fantastic.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. When you're doing a play or a film or whatever, do you like a lot of direction? Do you like the director to tell you exactly what to do? Or do you like to kind of work it out?
God, I love a good director. Most of them can't direct traffic. Really. But, you know, a lot of people won't direct Paul Lynde, and that's their mistake, because I always love to learn. I always like to be better mm-hmm. than I can be. And they, anymore, you know, I've become so identified as Paul Lynde, and the directors very rarely direct me. They mm-hmm. just say, oh, let Paul do his thing. And I love to be directed. I love the challenge, and mm-hmm. I love for a director to come up and say, I think you can do that better. I don't get mad or throw a scene, mm-hmm. if I respect him especially.
Yeah.
And that's when it's exciting, when they make you the best you can be.
Yeah, yeah. How Hollywood Squares, I know, is continuing to go beautifully. How long can that show go on, do you think?
I don't know. I really don't know. I have no idea. It's a total mystery to me. It really,
really
is. It really is. I do not I do not understand. People ask me that. We had a luncheon today with lots of the press here in Atlanta, and of course they asked me about that enigma of Hollywood Squares, and the only way I could answer it was that it must be a very revealing show. It must show the American people what we're really like, because when you're on it 13 years, as long as I've been, they feel that they know you as well as anyone in their family. Mm-hmm. And I think that is it. It has to be, because I don't understand it either.
What a talking about responsibility, though, what a responsibility to have to go on that show, you know, five times a week and come up with something very funny each time. And yet you manage to do that.
Well, keep your fingers crossed for me and wish me all your luck.
What are you planning on now? What after you finish Impossible Years, what are you going on to?
Well, we close on September 3rd in Houston, which Houston's a marvelous reward. Mm-hmm. I hope it's not too humid. Your shoes mildew overnight. But I will probably have to go back to Hollywood immediately and resume Hollywood Squares for a couple of days. Mm-hmm. Because they're going to start taping before I get off this tour. And then I want to go to New York and see Alice Ghostly, mm-hmm. who is now in Annie. Mm-hmm. And I want to see Dracula, because I hear Langella is just...
Yeah.
I want to see it before he leaves it. Mm-hmm. I want to see Dancing that Bob Fosse's done. I want to just go to New York, which is, you know, it's hardly a vacation, because I never go to bed.
Yeah.
there's no bed in New York. That's how it turns me on. And then I'm going to return to my home and have a dog I bought this summer, mm-hmm. Delivered to me, that I named Alfred Lunt. Lynn, are you watching? Does it go to Milwaukee?
We have used up 30 minutes.
Oh, really? Well,
already. Good. Listen, I hope everybody will go see you in Impossible Years at Theater of the Stars. And will you come back and see us again here?
I sure will, Jim.
Okay.
You're very easy, very
Thank you.
Pleasant.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
My thanks to all of you for watching. Until next time, good night.